areas of linguistics, like psycholinguistics and phonetic linguistics and things like that. But my kind of primary goal is to give introduction to me as an artist who has a background in Slavic languages and kind of trace the linguistic distance and the way it stretches and folds from east to west, so as it goes from eastern countries to western countries. And however, I am from a family of language professionals and it has always been a part of my life, so I'm hoping that I can kind of open some new doors for you. And as this talk comes from like quite a personal place for me, I want to give a quick introduction to my own practice. So, and I will later email you a list of references that I kind of use most of some of the book, like the kind of text and other things that I'm using at the moment, so that maybe you might want to have a look at them. And I was born in Moscow, Russia, and throughout my life I'm in three different countries, so I have developed this kind of mentality of appropriation, I suppose, and it had a huge relationship in the way that I work with language. And my practice is a narrative-based one, and I work primarily with texts and subjects of translation, appropriation, and immigration, and I'm going to touch on these. And it's important to say that I consider my nationality to be an immigrant. I do not subscribe to any particular country or culture, but I receive and accumulate everything from all over the place, basically. And I come from quite a bipolar artistic background, which I'm going to focus this lecture on. And the first one is the classic Russian art school, where this is what you do, basically. I was particularly tortured by Socrates, whom I thoroughly hate. Not the writing, but just the image. It's horrible. I spent 1 year drawing this with perfect proportion. And sort of the creative logic is based on realism, classical Russian art school. And it based on realism and repetition and requires careful observation, like very, very like careful attention to detail. But also at the same time, you know, it is not the shape that you learn to translate, but the feeling of the shape. You know, it's not the kind of the warmth of the sun, and it's the smoothness of the cube, and it's the perfection of geometric form, and it's not about how accurately the subject is depicted necessarily, but it's about how carefully you can translate the emotional feeling of that object. And of course, all of this comes from language, and you can see that often in classic Russian literature, you may find descriptions of locations which are based on purely emotional data, and leaving the reader a chance for a pictorial imagination or an interpretational distance. And the two, so some of these are, for example, the paintings that we used to look at in terms of the interpretational and the enhancement of things that we kind of wanted to have a look. And these are classic Russian painters, Ivan Shishkin and Arkady Kuryagin, and all of them work with the kind of transmission of the aura, I suppose. And this is something that we're always focused on the classic Russian art school. And I've chosen two paragraphs from the classic piece War and Peace, partially, for me personally, I don't like War and Peace. I know that this is a controversial statement, but I've chosen it because obviously we have an international audience here and probably everybody's familiar with such a milestone as War and Peace. Probably everybody heard of it at least once. And you can see how basically Tolstoy builds a distance. At first, a very close one, but without making any physical description of the subject. So the first one reads, "The old oak, artily transformed, draped in a tent of sappy dark green, buffed faintly, undulating in the rays of the evening sun. Of the knotted fingers, the gnarled excrescences, the aged grief and mistrust, nothing was to be seen. Through the rough, century-old bark, where there were no twigs, leaves had burst out so sappily, so young, that it was hard to believe that the aged creature had grown upon." And you can really kind of feel how closely the person must be looking at this. And this is for quite a famous scene. It's the meeting of Prince Andrei with the oak, a meeting with the oak, I mean, okay. And the second one really builds the distance. It's, "By the morning, the night's fog had left only hoar frost turning into dew on the heights. But in the hollows, the fog still spread in milk-white sea. Nothing could be seen in that hollow to the left, into which our troops had descended, and from which came the sounds of gunfire. Over the heights was a dark, clear sky, and to the right, the enormous pool of sun. Far ahead, on the other shore of the sea of fog, one could make out the jutting wooden hills on which the enemy army was supposed to be, and something was discernible. Now from here, we go to the tradition that has been actually very widely exhibited in the UK, especially last year because of the centenary of the Great Russian Revolution, and it is Moscow conceptualism. And it is the second part of my education. This is where I mainly come from. I was basically brought up by two artists who were the survivors, let's call them, of the Moscow conceptualism. And you can still see...
I didn't know that.
Oh.
Wow.
Hello.
Because I'm so interested in the Russian conceptual.
Mm. Okay. Did you go to that trip to Dmitry Prigozhin?
Yeah,
so I had a bit of a rant there. Oops. Sorry.
I love the Kavakov shows.
So does your parent generation have interacted with, or that's for the...
No, that's basically, so I went to this like art school where it wasn't really an art school, it was basically an artist's workshop. And so I pretty much spent there all of my time apart from just like regular, you know, middle school where I went, and I've spent there 7 years, you know, helping them shape their practice, but also kind of learning a lot about Moscow conceptualism. And I kind of, as a like, so as a small child, I got abused with a lot of like terms like, I don't know, the like Zeitgeist and Gesamtkunstwerk, and also like some other things.
What do those words mean?
So Gesamtkunstwerk is a total work of art, which is actually a term introduced by Wagner, but it was used quite a lot by Moscow conceptualists because they work primarily in installation to create the kind of the total kind of theatrical concept of art. And Zeitgeist is sort of like a spirit of time, you can apply it everywhere. But for Moscow conceptualists, it was kind of very interesting. And and Moscow conceptualism kind of practices quite a different approach, and it is a meaning-based narrative. So it's not an emotional narrative, it is a meaning-based narrative. And they work with language quite a lot. Like here you can say it's a piece by Ilya and Emilia Kavakovsky, just had a huge retrospective with the Tate Modern. It's not one anymore. And it says, do not clean. And it says it exactly in the typeface that you would find in Moscow Underground. On the doors, you will have the stickers, please don't lean on the doors. And they worked a lot with this like tradition of classic Russian art school and kind of, in a way, trying to exploit it as a canvas to accentuate how outdated it is and how stuck we are sometimes in all these old traditions. And so, The whole genre was born under the pressure of the Soviet regime, and the artists were mostly exhibiting their works in quite famous apartment shows that were called Kvartirniki. It's an apartment show where basically one of the artists was donating their apartment to be completely sort of turned upside down. You know, the walls were painted, the furniture was thrown away, and all these amazing kind of environments were born. And why was that? Is because it was illegal for police to go into a private property without the appropriate paperwork. So this is basically kind of the background for that. And artists felt that they had to remove as much of self from the artwork as possible, and that is one way of removing a distance, you know, the artistic distance. You just remove your own self, and that way you kind of, you speak from the kind of so-called public voice or the announcer voice. And you're kind of like this invisible narrator posing a question to the audience. And this is what a lot of Moscow conceptions here. So this is what artwork by Dmitry Prigov, who also had recently shown covered, well not recently, it was in November, at Colbert 22. And he uses, this particular piece is a bit of concrete poetry, and on one side it says, be ready, and on the other end it says, I'm not ready for this idea. And they're basically collapsing. And so, they kind of use the language of state, the language of state announcements against the state. If you were in a big city, you would find that there were all of these loudspeakers around public squares that would announce the news or the like the national radio or something like that. So the kind of the announcer voice was always there and was always present. And Of course, this had a huge impact on Russian language. You know, for 70 years, you're having this constant removal of self and art. And initially, Russian language has a similar mechanism for creating new words as German does. So you basically just merge two words together in a phonetically sound way. If it sounds pleasantly, then it's okay. So that's why Russian language has one of the most vibrant dictionaries, because there is really no such thing as slang. Like, there is, of course, root slang, but all new words that you create, they are already immediately included in the dictionary. So you can become the creator of a word very easily. And in Soviet times, the focus was kind of shifted from the communicative to metaphorical. So you wouldn't just merge two words. You would merge two words that sort of don't really make sense, but in a certain context, they become metaphorical. You know, the words have become these kind of code names and double-deck sentences in order to create hidden meanings. And unfortunately, the government was keeping up, so they had like a proper list of some of these code names, and they were constantly monitoring. But luckily, a lot of artists have managed to survive, because unfortunately, most of the artists were sent to nuclear mines, and none of them have returned back. There were huge raids on these apartment shows in the 1980s, and most of them have died within 1 year of exposure to uranium. And so, I mean, you can have a look at the catalogues. I think there is a catalogue for the Ilya and Milly Kabakov's show. They work with language a lot.
What's the name of that show?
It was just, good question.
The Kabakov show.
The cover. It was just Ilya and Emilia Kabakov. I'm going to include
it.
Is this the one we went to?
No, it was a time modern. It was called something like
The Red Star. I think it was Into the Future.
I'm going to include it in my send-out email. If you want to.
Not everyone will be in the future. It was quite a negative title. Not everyone will make it.
You could Google it in 1 second and find out.
No.
Take Capricorn. It's like, I need my ring anymore.
Okay. So, I mean, what is so special about Moscow conceptualism, and why am I going to talk about it? So there are three books on the table here that I brought, and they're basically sort of British, American, and Russian conceptualist publications. One of them is like a huge sort of merging of all of them together, which is called Conceptual Art in Britain. Another one is just a photographer that I really like that works with not really text, but text as metadata and kind of measuring. And the other one is Timur, who is one of the lesser known underground Russian artists who worked with pictograms, and pictograms as the kind of language. So, this is another kind of piece by Ilya and Milly Kabakov, which is called Clear Sky, and it is framed in a way that you would frame a kind of architectural drawing. So it is basically, it has like a description of what is it, this is the sky, and this says clear sky, so it's the kind of play with all of this hierarchical linguistic framing. And so, what is kind of the difference? So on one side here I have John Kutuf, One in Three Chairs, very famous work. And on the other I have Dmitry Prudov's piece, Aya, which basically are two letters, the first letter of the Russian alphabet and the last letter of the Russian alphabet, but also, when said, they mean, what about me? So Aya means, what about me? But these are also the first and the last letters. And it was actually one of the pieces that was exhibited in the Congress. And you can clearly see how Kasuth instrumentalizes the language here. He just uses the dictionary definition to add the kind of, to create an object with it. You know, it's not the language, it's not the linguistic matter that he uses it. He just utilizes it as a medium. Whereas here, it is both the medium and the instrument. And this is what makes Moscow conceptualism so special. It is because they worked primarily with language because of the restraints of the regime and because they thought this was the best way for them to kind of get heard. So, as you can imagine, this kind of bipolar bringing really torn my work methodology into kind of two directions, and right now I practice this thing which is called impulsive hiding, and I am impulsively hiding my own self from my work, and I work primarily with the viewing distance and kind of somewhat managing it and enriching it, because I believe that it is something that we believe is a collateral material, it's something that comes with the artwork, it's viewing distance, but I think it is actually the primary data of the artwork that you're working with. And I would like to kind of clarify that when I talk about a distance between an artwork and a viewer, and for example a distance between two strangers, you know, who you haven't met, ever met, it is the same distance. What kind of, the only difference is its length. And the length, it kind of lies in the hierarchy that the language imposes on us. And each of this level of hierarchy is at a bit of viewing distance. But the paradox is that we actually need the viewing distance, so in a way we need a little bit of hierarchy there to form productive conversation. However, that conversation is no longer equal when the hierarchy is introduced. For example, right now, we're having an equal sort of exchange, we're having an equal distance, because you have signed up for the workshop and I'm here, and if you're not happy, you can move out, right? But don't. And so now, just to kind of give myself a break for tea, I want to ask you a quick question. Could you, each of you, say a couple of words about, or maybe like three key words or a sentence, whatever amount you find appropriate, what separates you from other people sitting at this table? What is the distance between you and other people sitting at this table? How would you describe this distance?
Someone sitting on this table?
Between you and other people sitting at this table. Yeah, have like 1 or 2 minutes to think. Okay, anybody ready to start?
I just have one.
That's good.
Table length.
Sorry?
Table length.
Table length. Oh, that's pretty literal.
That's the first thing that popped in my mind.
But is it like, I mean, the conference table that we're sitting on, you know, it's a pretty special length. Right. I don't know if you've ever been to like conferences. You know, it's a different length than the one that you have at a dinner table.
Yes.
So what kind of, I don't know, any kind of ways that you can elaborate on that table distance?
I'm just thinking of it this way, kind of ignoring whatever's next to me.
Oh, okay.
As if no one can read my notes and I'm sitting
on my own. So it's, in a way, the distance is kind of alienation, right?
Yes.
You're kind of falsely alienating everything and creating the single distance.
Yeah.
Okay, that's interesting.
So what's the ideal form of the table?
Oh no, I don't
know. Did you pencil? I think,
I don't
you know what I wrote down of my to-do double page? Because I think this table doesn't fit to the purpose of this occasion here. Because it's like, you have always like this problem. Yeah. You have this row here and somebody's speaking and you can't see each other, so actually it should be like a triangle.
Yeah, but then it really puts you on the spotlight, doesn't it? If there is literally an arrow pointing at you.
Yeah, but everybody could see you without doing this
if
all the
time.
If
you want everybody to see everybody, then it should be like a perfect circle, isn't it?
Yeah, it depends on the
Yeah, this is the closest
event
we can get for like a circle.
Actually, it should be shapeable.
Yeah, that too.
Yeah. My description would be like intimate, to be honest. I've never been this close to people. In RCA.
Oh, just in the tube.
I'm actually going to talk about it. This is
in
the
RCA, I mean.
Ah, no.
Yeah, anybody else? Is that the distance?
Always distance.
So is it something that you like constantly just walk around with? Just is it the same when you're? So imagine the situation that you're sitting at this table and then it's all happening in your you know, in Iran, in your home country, then what would the distance be then? Oh, there would be no distance. That's the interesting one.
Yeah, the distance won't be the language, but yeah, still there should be some distances. I guess always we have some distances from other people. We are not never in equal and very same. I think always there is a distance between people.
But do you feel like it's a kind of negative distance, or is it a positive distance? Yeah. Or you're not really giving it a connotation?
Yeah, but generally, from the RCA, if I want to talk, it's in a very negative distance, not in a positive distance.
Okay. Responses. On one hand, it's this like table length alienation, on the other hand, it's vulnerability. Mm-hmm. That's pretty interesting.
I think what creates distance is the belief that there is distance in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
If you presuppose that there is an inherent distance between people, and whether it's positive or negative, you're always going to approach it like that. But if you look at it in the sense that there actually is no distance, and it's just a creation of our thoughts and language and whatnot, then
I'm
not saying I'm like a Buddha or anything, but sometimes I do think about this.
They all came from different backgrounds, right? We are aware in the society that it's like a social difference between like basically everyone, right? So when we came here, we didn't get out from our own background, we opened our own backgrounds here. So there is a distance per se, because you are aware of it already. Not that like you don't think of it, of course it wasn't there if you didn't think of it, but you are thinking of it already.
Yeah, I think the distance is also, it's not the distance between you and me, like literally and metaphorically, it's also the distance to my home country that is like so far away that brings me so close to you. Because I allowed myself to.
Yeah, I mean, it is a funny thing, right? Because, I mean, as a long-term immigrant, I feel more distance when I go back to my home environment than I feel here, for instance. There is a huge distance there, and the society actively rejects you as a foreigner, because for them you're a foreigner, but then here you're also a foreigner. So where the fuck you are in foreigner? Then there's the question. Yeah, but I mean, the one sort of thing that I've learned, like throughout my kind of immigration history, is that basically people everywhere, like as you said, people everywhere are the same. So there is no such thing as mental or physical difference. But the only difference that exists there is the linguistic difference. And the language is something that actually prompts, you know, the conflicts, the contact of conflicts and the exchange. And it's the way, and so I strongly believe that the distance is there, because for me, even the physical distance already manifests the mental difference. It's just the way that you manage it, whether it's a positive, it's a negative space, whether you don't believe it is a black and white, it's a positive, it is a negative space. How can you manipulate it? So these are some of the questions that you can work with. And the kind of the dichotomy of this, and of the one that this sort of Moscow conceptualism is for me, is really something between, you know, the East and West. And it, for example, when I'm talking about the East, I'm talking about Russia, which is the most eastern of the Eastern European countries, it's technically 70% Asia. So, I mean, it's even like, it's technically. And when I'm talking about the West, for me, West are countries like Poland, countries like Czech Republic. And there, if you think about the hierarchies, it's more of a familial-based hierarchy rather than an individual-based hierarchy. And in society, you kind of build a reputation for your family, for your community, for your city, and then you kind of live with that your reputation. And in the Eastern countries, the reputation is more individual based because you have the only kind of thing that you wear is a patronymic name. Your patronymic name, you all have a patronymic name, is something that you bear with you, and it allows for a comparative analysis with you in particular. How much have you grown from your father? How much have you gained or lost in your social position, in your wealth, in your knowledge? And this is something that is still quite actively traced in these societies. And for example, we use also very hierarchical distance in a way that we have in Russian language and in most southern and western Slavic countries. We have different pronouns for different types of hierarchical positioning. And when you meet a new person, no matter what age they are, what kind of, you know, even if it's somebody who's younger than you, you still use that pronoun, which is very respectful, and only after a mutual consideration you may go to a more informal form. And the linguistic hierarchy is mostly based on age. So age is something that, whereas in the Western world, it's more of a societal status. In Slavic countries, your societal status doesn't matter as much, and your gender actually doesn't matter as much. There is no really such thing as like an active gender, sort of, I suppose, gender hierarchy. And for example, you may never disagree with somebody who's older than you, never. You may never disagree with somebody who has a higher sort of level of knowledge or wealth or something else than you. And such thing as debate can only exist within the same social or age level, which, as you can probably think, is really frustrating, because most likely people of your own social position, your own age, will have similar ideas, right? So there is no really ground for debate. It's like really frustrating. And all these things that I'm talking, they're still at play right now. They're still at play in countries like Belarus, Ukraine, Russia, Bulgaria. I mean, the more Western you go, the more sort of democratized it becomes. But sort of, okay, where am I at? You know, I wrote this note and I was like, I'm going to really go step by step with it. And then I already mixed half of it. Yeah, and for example, when I'm talking about physical distance, I remember that for me, it was like a groundbreaking thing when I came to England that people do handshakes and hugs. I was like, don't touch me, I'm scared. You know, like that YouTube video. And so in Russia, private space, like a personal space, is like the most... it's like the most precious thing that you have. So a respectful conversation would involve zero physical contact. Even like with close friends or relatives, you would never like even attempt to touch.
How do you greet each other?
You just say hi. You just say hi.
So it's like a sound.
Yeah, it is a sound. You just say hi.
It's not even a wave.
Well, you can wave if you're from a distance. You can't find each other on the other hands of the like tube station. You go hi.
And then if you see each other, you don't even get close like to hug. No.
Yeah, you really like. Like when I'm, for example, with my Russian friends, like when we just meet, we say hi, and when we like say goodbye, we just say goodbye and we walk away. So, you know.
For us, we have to kiss.
Yeah, I know.
So intimate. Like we kiss when we meet and we kiss when we part.
I know. So I'm like proper doing research about how do people greet each other in different countries. So when I'm like in a situation, I'm not like all of a sudden startled, but like, okay, like what is about to happen right now? Like how awkward it's going to be. It is very easy to get lost in this kind of distance translation. And the kind of principle that I have attained is that you accommodate to the situation. But the side effect is that obviously you lose your ground zero and you kind of become this sort of always morphing, always kind of changing person, and you kind of lose your own culture, I suppose. And yeah, I suppose, where's my next slide goes? Oh, okay. So I'm gonna talk a little bit about distance and dialogue. And why dialogue? It's because of everybody's least favorite question. What's everybody's least favorite question?
Where are you from?
Well, you
really apart from that, in an artistic context,
what's your art about?
The least favorite question is, what is art? It is the moment when you just want to like grab something really heavy.
Yeah,
something very illegal. Yeah, but I mean, the easy answer to that is a dialogue. And you can already see in the, like, the linguistic construct of it, it is a dialogue. A dialogue is a linguistic entity. And the Oxford Online Dictionary gives the answer to what is dialogue. It is a discussion between two or more people or groups, especially one directed towards exploration of a particular subject or resolution of a problem. And so it is clear that in the metadata of each artwork, it is shaped as an idea and as a proposition. And the proposition is that of overcoming of a distance. And there is no such thing as unreachable distance, you know, as there is no such thing as like inexplicable art. You know, there are no such things. And the idea that kind of defines, this idea defines the branch of contemporary art, which is actually called conceptualism. So all the like American conceptualists, Russian conceptualists, they all work with the idea of overcoming of a distance, overcoming of a proposition in their work. And I actually really, really hate the word conceptual art. And the reason that I hate it so much is that because it builds up additional layer of distance between you and between the artwork. You know, and it is quite a paradoxical one, but narrowing something down to a definition, for example, calling a piece of conceptual art, actually increases the distance. So the more you explain it, the more distance there is. Because it doesn't become easier. You know, the more you explain, the more questions you have. It's like trying to explain something to like a toddler. It's impossible. You know, you just give up. And also, now I'm gonna go into more of a like technical part of it. And it is that if you look at the use of different, at the kind of linguistic, I suppose, way of collapsing and narrowing down the distance, you know, and when we look at words like not far away, nearby, in the meantime, whilst, from far away, or afar, you know, it's not the kind of the making the words more basic, it is really creating the linguistic distance, and it really is about shaping. And we're going to do an exercise based on that after I finish with my probably script for a PhD, I don't know what that is. And do you remember when we looked at these descriptions from Leo Tolstoy? So now I want to introduce something that is completely different, and it's from Franz Kafka's The Castle. And the bit that I chose is this one. So you're asking for the impossible. Why is it impossible, asked Cade. I'll explain it to you, said the landlady in a tone of voice that suggested her explanation was not some final favor she was doing with him, but rather the first punishment she was inflicting on him. I shall be glad to give you an explanation. I know I don't belong to the castle. I'm only a woman. I'm only a landlady at the inferior inn. It's not the worst, but it's not far from it. So you may not attach much importance to my explanation, but I've kept my eyes open during my life and come in contact with a lot of people, and I've taken on all the work of running the inn myself. And it continues like that for a page and a half. So can you imagine how big of a distance Kafka manages to build with only making, sort of dressing this woman in this invisible hierarchy, like a coat after one, after another, after another. So, and it's just, and it's very easy because you just physically add more words, but you also have to be very careful what kind of words you use. Like in the meantime, and whilst, from far away and afar. And as the last thing, I'm gonna indulge my own ego a little bit, and I'm gonna show my own sort of exercises that I do, which are created during train journeys. And I think that train journey is something that really makes you very focused on the idea of a distance and of overcoming of distance. And I do this exercise which I call side writings, and this is one of them. It's very short. this piece was, I've made quite a few of these exercises, and this one was made during a 6-hour train trip from Oslo to, no, sorry, from Bergen to Oslo. And so the last thing that I'm going to ask you to do is, it's quite an easy exercise, but I think it's really interesting. Like, I found it personally very interesting, but I did the same one as before. Is that I want you to take, there's different parts that make, so all of these different kind of bricks make words that describe different kinds of distance, and I want you to create a new word from it. Think about something that, for example, exists in your mother tongue and does not exist in English, and try to construct a new word and then a sentence for these new words to go into. And obviously, these are not, if you can think about any other bits or bricks that I've missed, please feel free to add them. And I think, let's make it a 5-minute thing. Let's make it very quick. So you make a new word and you make a sentence to go. For this new word to go into. Sorry. Well, these are the building bricks for you.
So you just
sort of combine them.
Yeah, you just combine them in you combine them as if you were combining them in Russian, which means that you just merge anything you'd like and make it sound phonetically good. You know, it's one of the. It's actually pretty similar to one of the exercises that I did when I did graphic design, which is where the task was to, because Russian alphabet has 33 letters, it's much bigger than the Latin alphabet, and the task was to invent 3 new letters, make a typeface with these 3 new letters, and make the teacher search for it for 1 minute. So if the teacher searches for the new letters for longer than 1 minute, then you've succeeded. So. I want you to make something very convincing. So, okay, I'm timing it. 5 minutes, let's go.
Camera.
time ever. The funny thing is that the word that you have created exists in Russian language.
Okay. So it would make sense to say in Russian, she arrived in all her farms.
Farms. So how would you, like, if you were to write a definition for this word, how would you define it?
Like, it's within yourself, like, within someone. Like inherent distance, like withdrawal from yourself or something like that.
So it's a distance of withdrawal from yourself?
From, I think, not necessarily from yourself, but from everything, or just like this sort of state of not being unreachable in a way.
What does the Russian word mean?
It sounds далече. I'm just writing this down. I'm going to create a little vocabulary for these gents today. Florence. Okay. I mean, I think you could describe that table distance that you spoke about earlier with that word, Florence. It's a table Florence. You know, you're unavailable at the conference table, which is pretty much everybody at the conference. right, next one.
Right. My word is will be, or while be.
Perhaps. While be. Okay.
Which is a combination of wow and Bajanovich. So my sentence is, Matilda went into the hallway for her slippers. While be, the kettle had already boiled over.
Oh, okay. So that's basically just a definition. Well, what's the difference between the whilst and while be?
Because wealth does not imply final and the action that has happened in the context.
Okay, so it implies the final.
Whereas by the time of which implies that something happened.
So if you were to write a definition for this word, what would it be?
It would be a description that it's... I was thinking it's kind of like a combination of the perfect and the imperfect. Is it both implies a continuous action? Like in Russian, it's like submission and agreement, right? Like something that's completed and not completed. So it's like we encapsulate both the sense of the thing happening and the sense of it having happened.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That's interesting.
I just thought sound cool too.
Sorry?
I thought sound cool.
Yeah.
But then I didn't say that loud.
So how do you spell it? It's
W-H-I-L-N-E-Y.
Okay. That sounds like a name for something. Okay, next.
My choice is by fair. B-Y-F-E-R.
By fair. Okay.
Because I think there's a word in fear, and I think fear is the meaning of fear is like an influence. So I want by fear to be like a meaning of because of, like the presenters.
Oh, so by means of something, or?
By fear, the master course, I've learned a lot about economics. So it's like a because of. So it's like replacing the place.
Okay, that's interesting. I can actually see, you know, it's a usable word. Like, you can really use it, by fear.
Yeah, I was involved with this and on the combination, by fear from, it can used to be apart from, but it can add a meaning, to the apart, and it can add a meaning of it influenced by it, but apart from it, there's another way.
Cool. Nazi?
Nearby.
Wait. Okay. What the hell does that mean?
Yeah, the sentence is a jam nearby step.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, why nearby?
I don't know. Just I thought that none of them makes sense for me, and I just wanted to have a meaning from the word.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, then maybe we can get a bit creative with the definition for the word nearby. How would you, what would be the definition for the word nearby be?
It should be near B, not nearby. No? If you connect them.
Near B. Near B sounds cool.
Yeah.
Okay. Nearby. It's going to be near B then. Rachel.
Near B is like when your B is near BU.
Oh God.
It's more near than
near B.
I bet if I type it down the Urban Dictionary right now, it's gonna come up.
My B is near BB.
Toad's near B. Okay, Rachel.
Rachel.
Are your toads near B?
I don't know. Rachel slept for 3 hours in what seemed to her like 3 minutes. She was lost in enter time.
Wow. Enter time.
Enter time. I-N-T-E-R. Maybe that's a word. I don't know.
It sounds like some kind of enter time. It's probably some kind of sports terminology, isn't it?
I was thinking it was from Star Wars.
But let's add it to the Urban Dictionary. Let's make a different definition for it.
It's the space outside of the so-called normal experience of time.
So then what would be the word for a normal experience of time?
Time.
Okay. Next. Sorry, I didn't know your name.
Sorry, I wasn't here.
Oh, you weren't here. Okay.
So my word is Hanuki, and this word describes.
How would you spell it?
H A N U K I.
Based on which
word? Okay.
And in my original poem, it was nearby.
Okay.
And nearby, I wrote down a definition for nearby for me. The end of iteration and the beginning of emergence. Mm-hmm. And so when you come, so Hanuki, I think, describes the process where you, where something altered at a particular point where something new emerges. So I thought I will build regarding your advice that it has some pronunciation relationship to the meaning, so like Hanuki, so the H is like very like subtle, and then it becomes more emphasized, like A and Hanuki and Ki. I think like because
that's a very German approach to it.
I thought like okay, like at the end you get like more attention because something new emerged, and so I thought, okay, like intonation.
So what are the two words that you put together? What are the two words?
We should just refer to the two words.
Yeah, it doesn't have to be like specifically the words from this, you can make up your own words.
So what are the two?
It was just
what's
like a guidance.
Ones?
I just put, I just relate to nearby, actually.
Okay, cool.
That's an origin point. Yeah. So Hanuki Ki is like the crying baby, like, has like more intonation and it grabs more attention because it's just makes more curious, maybe because it's not, nobody knows it at the point, at the former state.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, next one.
I have from me.
From
me.
Okay. With love. Something like an ending of it. Okay, and what does that mean?
So it's like, so imagine, if I said that she's a very frummy person, it's a person that is always talking about her homeland.
Okay. How would you see that? So you would normally apply it to a person. Okay. And do you write it together, like with a dash or something? Just together. Okay. Next one, Shama.
I thought we have to pick from up here.
Yeah, you could.
Far jam.
Far jam. I thought about it myself.
It sounds pretty.
And what does that mean? How would you put it in a sentence?
You guys help me out.
What did you think?
Like it's like you're stuck, but you're
stuck
anticipating
for
being stuck.
So it's like being stuck, but being like. Is it like being really stuck, basically?
No, like being stuck, but not in the moment.
Oh, so like
anticipating being stuck.
Anticipating being stuck.
Like,
it's going to be a far jam.
Yeah, or like expect a far jam in that lecture.
That already happened. You didn't have to anticipate it.
Quite fast.
When the police chase you into a dead end.
Yeah.
Okay.
And where you're anticipating it.
I'm gonna get into a far jam.
like traffic.
No, like.
Hey, oh yeah, or traffic.
Or like being.
Okay, next one.
Alright, so I totally misunderstood the assignment, so I mixed two words in Arabic, but then I kind of saved it. But
no, that was the, you could have done that as well, but then obviously like it would help us to have a translation for that in English.
Yeah, so I was thinking, because we were talking about greeting, how when someone wants to greet you by way of kissing your cheeks and then misses and doesn't know how to act.
Yeah.
So I was thinking of calling that a mispass.
Mispass, okay. Is that two double S's or one M-I-S?
Yeah, it could be.
Okay. So that is
missing.
An act of missing.
Missing and then passing on to the baby.
Okay. So that's basically just in, like, okay. Misinterpreting a greeting.
Yes.
Awkward woman. You're a greeting.
Okay. No.
A term called cross pass.
Cross pass.
It was a feeling of losing something, but the thing wasn't there for long. Like when I was freshman in my college, there was a Burger King in my neighborhood. And when I was near to, like somehow it closed down, and then it was like gone forever. And then we were so sad. I was like, oh, the Burger King has been here forever. But the thing is, and then like the teacher told us, yeah, it has been here for like 2 years. Like, that was just it. Before that, it was a McDonald's or what the fuck is that?
Mm.
But it was here for just 2 years, and it sounds like it was here like forever. So you lose a thing that wasn't there for long.
Mm.
Okay.
Mm, nice.
That had a really impact on your life, didn't it? Okay, and the last one.
I need
to
like
make
kind of sense of
it. Yeah. How do you spell that?
F-A-R.
Far relate. Okay, that's interesting.
And the sentence is, he feels far relate when I wait on time and close to the step.
Hmm.
And I kind of imagine like a something is gonna, is just gonna begin. But you feel like
okay. So it's like this kind of the suspension moment before something is going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting. Okay. That's interesting. Do I have anything else? No, I have a thank you. Thank you, everybody.